Hi guys and welcome back to my channel. Apologies that I haven't been posting as much as I would have liked to. If you've watched my last video, you would have known that lockdown restrictions have eased in England and the UK, and so I've been going out and having a bit of a social life, so I do apologise for that, but I'm still here, I'm still creating videos for you guys. So as you would have guessed from the title of this video, today we're talking about audiobooks, which is still another part of the publishing industry. Apologies if you can hear that massive wind that is going on right now. I don't know why it's so heavy. So as I said, audiobooks are a massive part of the publishing industry, and essentially it's another method to read books. And I always find it weird when people say they're reading a book even though they're listening to it, but audiobooks are a massive part of the publishing industry and arguably is growing along with ebooks. Do let me know if you're a fan of audiobooks. I myself am not actually a massive fan of audiobooks. I prefer to read hardbacks and paperback books. However, you might be listening to audiobooks on your commute, you might be listening to audiobooks on your walk. Let me know in the comments section below. Today, however, I'm going to give you just a bit of a basic rundown of what audiobooks are, the history of audiobooks, how audiobooks are made at Bloomsbury, who reads audiobooks, how much audiobooks cost, how popular audiobooks are, and giving some examples of the best-selling audiobooks out there. So make sure you stick around for the whole of this video to learn more about audiobooks, whether you're a lover or a hater. Watch out as well, because I will be in future posting a video on the pros and the cons of audiobooks. So let's get into it. So if you've been following my YouTube journey for a little while now, you know that I trained in publishing with the LDN apprenticeships. And as part of that at Bloomsbury, I spent a day or two with the audio team at Bloomsbury. Now the audio team just consists of two people, or did at the time a couple of years ago when I was training in Bloomsbury. And the two guys actually sat opposite me in our office. So I was always hearing conversations going on about audiobooks and basically was listening to their conversations. So I asked those guys one day if I could basically just spend a day with them, and as part of my apprenticeship qualification that I did, I was allocated that time and I was allowed to just forget about my production work for the day and go and spend it in audio. So that's exactly what I did, and I can't wait to tell you about what it was like spending the day at our audio recording studio. Now, along with just going to the studio and listening to some of our audiobooks being made, I obviously learned a lot about audiobooks, and that is what I'm sharing with you today. So let's go right back to the beginning and talk about the history of audiobooks. So audiobooks first originated in the UK for the Royal National Institute for the Blind, when they wanted to see if they could produce talking books for the blind. And this was just in the 1920s. I'm interested to hear if you thought it was earlier than that, later than that. Let me know in the comments section below. In 1969, audiobooks changed from gramophones to disc tapes. This made it easier to use, lightweight and compact. And then in the 90s, audiobooks on compact discs became more popular. And then finally, when the internet was introduced, audiobooks became much more popular because it was much easier for people to download. So how long are audiobooks? That's almost like asking how long is a piece of string, because if you have a novel that's only 100 pages, how do you possibly compare that to an audiobook of a novel that's 10,000 pages? Obviously, this will completely differ, but as an average, a novel can contain anywhere between 70,000 words and 120,000 words. Translate this into an audiobook and listening hours, this averages about to about 10 hours per book. So now I'm going to move on to how audiobooks are actually made. When you click download and you start listening in your AirPods and you're listening to this story being told through your ears, how did that actually come about? So obviously I'm completely talking from experience here and what we do at Bloomsbury, so obviously this will differ across different publishing houses, different audio teams, studios will be in different places, all that jazz. But this is just what it was like for me. So firstly, our audio team, the two that I mentioned before, they will work with sales and the sales department to work out what 150 to 200 titles are the most popular and essentially what they think should be available in audio format. They then use this to create their list, which they call their schedule. The audio team will then read the books all the way through and then come up with a list of narrators that they think might suit the audio book. They'll usually come up with about three people that they will pitch to the author and the editor. Typically for audio books, they are hired actors. They could be big or small. Names you've heard of, names you haven't. They then book a studio and arrange for the recording to take place. So, as I mentioned earlier in the video, I had the privilege of coming along to one of our recording studios, and it was a fantastic experience and I really did enjoy it. It was a little while ago now, but I do really remember it, and I did take a couple of photos while I was there, but I wish I captured more. So what was it like in my experience? I remember getting the train and the tube up there, and it was a place that I hadn't been to before because I don't live in central London, and it was really different to what I thought it was going to be. I'm not really sure what I was expecting because I hadn't even seen photos of an audio recording studio before either. Essentially you walk in and there's different rooms and there's different meeting rooms, etc., and then the one that we went into, you walk in and then there's the main control room, I think it's called, and that's where the person monitoring it will look at the different levels, make sure it sounds okay, and then there's a glass screen into a separate smaller room, which is where the actor will sit and read out the audio book. And it was my privilege. I basically just sat in that control room and listened in. I could hear the actor speaking, I heard the conversations about, can you say that again, can you put more of an intonation on this, and it basically just gave me a massive insight, just even just sitting there and listening to the conversations that were being had, how many times things had to be reset. And there's things about accents as well, like some things they weren't sure how to pronounce it and so they'd Google it. Another interesting thing that they do as well, if it's something that in a different language, for example, or say it's based in America rather than the UK, they'll basically send a word to like a professional and they'll come back with a recording of how they should say it. And obviously that takes a bit of time, but that's one of the methods that they use. And then it was just really interesting to see how strict some of the conversations were as well, about can you record that and have a slight pause after it. And obviously these things will be edited, but obviously you'd rather have as much footage as possible that you can work with, rather than getting to the editing stage and realizing that something's not been said correctly. So the recording is then edited by the studio manager and then it's sent to our audio department at Bloomsbury. And they aim for the recording to be edited and ready to go about a month before the publication date. This is also then sent to Audible, which you know is probably the biggest platform in audiobooks. And then a jacket cover also needs to be designed for the audiobooks, because I'm not sure if you've realised before, but audiobook covers need to be square in size, and so the audio department at Bloomsbury might have to liaise with the design team a little bit to make sure that every bit of information that is on the original jacket can be transferred onto a square jacket image. And then the audio team will meet every week to discuss progress on each title. Obviously each title will be at a different stage in the process, so some might be just deciding what actors to use, some might be deciding if the jacket needs redesigning, etc. They'll all be at different stages, but essentially the audio team will meet once a week to just talk through the titles. And now interestingly, the audio department at Bloomsbury is actually relatively new, and so just being two of them in the audio department at Bloomsbury, they express that it's kind of hard sometimes when they come across challenges and they don't really know who to turn to because there's no one in Bloomsbury else that can help them. And although they've got experiences individually, they are essentially left to control it themselves. I'm confident that our audio team will be expanding massively though, and this is just the beginning for us. Once the audio file has been created, the jacket image is created, sometimes we create promotional snippet videos as well to use for social media. So we'll use SoundCloud for that, and just say, have 30 seconds of an audio clip, for example. It might be the beginning of the very book, it might be a little snapshot of something exciting that's going on in the book, the beginning of a chapter, anything like that, that we can just post on social media and get people listening and excited to buy the actual full version of the audiobook. So who creates those? Well, sometimes we do it in-house at Bloomsbury, the audio team might do it, and then sometimes we might get the studio managers to do it as well. It really does depend on the title, how busy they are, etc. And then interestingly, this is all what's happening in the UK. What about the US? Well, sometimes the US will actually deal with everything and we will just buy the audio off them. So they'll find the actor, they'll record the audio, they'll get the snippets, and then they'll just send it to us for a fee. This essentially is much less work for us in the UK because the US is basically doing everything and we just need to pay a lump sum of money for that. So I think it's really nice, a quite simple process on how audiobooks are made, but obviously each stage comes with challenges for the audio team and they're just absolutely smashing it at the moment. But in basic terms, that's what happens from start to finish in audiobooks at Bloomsbury. Now moving on to who actually reads the audiobooks. So I've mentioned actors reading out the audiobooks, but is it always them? Is it big actors? Is it small actors? Well, as I mentioned before, it can be big actors, it can be people that you know, but then there also might be smaller names, and that is their full-time job to be a narrator for audiobooks, but they just might not be famous and in the eyes of the press. In contrast to this though, non-fiction books, so books about real life that tell true stories, these are usually actually read by the author themselves. Usually, because if you think about it, if it's a memoir, for example, that person, the author, is going to know exactly how things need to be said. And it's just it's a general kind of rule of thumb, if you like, that authors might read their non-fiction books themselves. So pros and cons of this, well, celebrities and big name narrators can be difficult because they might have a really busy schedule, they might have different expectations, they might be more expensive to hire. And then in contrast to that, if you think of authors, this is not their full-time job, they might not be a narrator, they might have had no experience whatsoever, and so it might take a lot longer for them to record it, redo things, and they might have to be basically guided through a lot. So the studios, now I can't go into too much detail about fees or anything, obviously, for confidentiality reasons, but we use about 10 studios at Bloomsbury, and we average about 25,000 words a day. That's what we kind of aim for when we're spending a day at the recording studio with an actor. And then the actor will receive a set fee per finished recording hour of the audiobook. So it doesn't matter if you've had to re-say the same sentence over and over again, they will be paid per finished hour of the audiobook. I suppose that's a really nice way of doing it from the studios, because you could be there for days and days and days, and that could be racking up all the pounds for your company, but essentially they're only going to charge you for how many hours it takes for your finished product. And then the studios can be hired as of when. You might do it over 3 consecutive days, you might do it over a week, or a few hours at a time, over a couple of weeks. It really does depend on the availability of the audio team, the studio managers, the studio bookings, the narrator, etc. I just wanted to butt in here as well, because I found a photo on my phone where I took a photo when I was just outside our recording studio. This isn't actually, I think I actually went to the wrong recording studio first of all, because they're really similar names or something. So I'll put it on the screen now, but I'm also just showing it to the camera. So it's basically this beautiful long walkway, and it listed all the studios. So how much do audiobooks actually cost? Now, you might have realised that audiobooks are a little more expensive than ebooks, where you just read the digital file on, say, your Kindle. Well, that's because obviously we have to pay a fee both to the studio and to the narrators. As I mentioned, at Bloomsbury we pay per finished hour. So then from the customer's point of view, audiobooks can be purchased as a one-time thing, or you can have subscriptions, so you have unlimited access to audiobooks a month, anything like that. It really does depend on what's available out there. But the average price for an audiobook is around about £20. So just for some examples, if you wanted to buy a subscription plan, you can pay monthly. So Kindle Unlimited offers access to unlimited audiobooks. Audible's membership includes one free audiobook a month, no matter the original cost of it. Up to 80% off selected audiobooks, unlimited access to documentaries and podcasts, and availability to listen offline as well. And then that membership is $7.99 a month. And then finally, Amazon Prime offers Prime Reading, which gives you access to a rotating list of Kindle books with audible narration. So how popular are audiobooks? As I mentioned, I personally don't myself listen to them. I don't know if you listen to them yourselves, let me know in the comments section down below. But the buying trends really do vary. So some books have fewer than 100 audio downloads, and then some have, say, 25,000 downloads. And then, having spoken to someone who previously worked at audio at HarperCollins, I learned that audio appeals to a demographic previously overlooked in publishing. So the main audience used to men aged around 25 to 35 in urban areas, rather than the traditional older female audience. Dominating genres tend to be non-fiction, self-improvement, and sci-fi or fantasy. Audio also tends to have a more diverse audience, with a higher percentage of BAME readers rather than print publishing as a whole. Let me know in the comment section down below what your thoughts on that are. Are you a young person listening to audiobooks? Where do you listen to audiobooks? On your commute, on your walks, etc.? And what genres are you listening to? So, bestsellers. There must be some books that sell more audiobooks than others. Maybe it's the narration, it's really enticing. Maybe it's the actual book. Maybe it's really long and you don't want to sit carrying a really heavy book. What are some of the best sellers? I wouldn't be working at Bloomsbury if I didn't mention Harry Potter. So one of the best sellers is Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone by J.K. Rowling, and it's read by Jim Dale. Then to give you a few more, we have A Game of Thrones, A Song of Ice and Fire, which is by George R.R. Martin, but read by Roy Dotrice. Then we have The Handmaid's Tale by Margaret Atwood, read by Claire Danes. Gone Girl by Gillian Flynn, read by Julia Whelan and Kirby Hayborn. And finally, To Kill a Mockingbird by Harper Lee, read by Sissy Spacek. So I'd love to know if you've listened to any of those or read any of those. Another thing that I learned on my day at the recording studio is how large audio files actually are. If you think about it, they're really high quality pieces of audio. And as I mentioned earlier, audio files typically per book are around 10 hours of narration long. And each hour of audible audiobooks averages about to 25 to 30 megabytes in high quality and about 15 megabytes in standard quality. So what does that mean for the customers? How long is that going to take me to download? It can be anywhere between 1 and 30 minutes, depending on the size of the audiobook and of course your internet speed. So I'm going to wrap it up now, guys, because that's kind of the basics of what I learned on my audio recording studio day. The two guys that took me through and let me tag along with them, I'm so grateful to them, and the actual audio studio as well for letting me come into their studios and have a little listen. I really hope you found that useful, and please do let me know down in the comment section below if you did find it useful. Your support means so much to me, and I'm really, really grateful for it. And don't forget that I'm doing a video soon as well on the pros and cons of audiobooks, so watch out for that. But for now, thank you so much for watching, and bye bye.